Hello and welcome to the Nave. It is so great to have you with us today. Wherever or whenever you're joining us, you are so welcome. Coming up in our service today, we're going to start with a time of sung worship as we bring honor and glory to our God. Then we're going to be having our reading for today, and Liz is going to be talking about the fruit of the Spirit, and the topic for today is joy. And then finally, we're going to finish off our service with a time of reflective prayer and worship. But before we get into any of that, let's spend some time now coming into God's presence, asking his forgiveness and mercy to be abundant in our lives, and knowing his Holy Spirit within us. So let's pray. Father, maker of heaven and earth, we have sinned against you in our thoughts, in our words, and in our actions, and have failed to do the things that we should have done. Lord, we are sorry and we truly repent of our sins. Lord, through the power of your Spirit, would you strengthen us to live and walk in this world as children of light and be changed into your likeness each day. Amen. Let's worship the Lord.
Of abundance flow, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name, when found in the desert place. Though I've walked through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing.
Give and take away. You give. reading from the book of Romans, Romans chapter 15. Accept one another then, just as Christ accepted you, in order to bring praise to God. For I tell you that Christ has become a servant of the Jews on behalf of God's truth, so that the promises made to the patriarchs might be confirmed, and moreover that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. As it is written, therefore I will praise you among the Gentiles. I will sing the praises of your name. Again it says, rejoice you Gentiles with his people. Again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let the peoples extol him. Again, Isaiah says, the root of Jesse will spring up, one who will arise to rule over the nations. In him the Gentiles will hope. Therefore, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Do you know one of the things that really used to annoy me, and I mean properly wind me up? I don't mean just a little bit. I mean really, really wind me up. Happy people. I know, happy people. You know, those really annoying people who go round and whatever is happening, they have this big smile on their face and they're like, oh, it's all right, it's no problem, everything's wonderful. And you know, no matter what's going on, they've got this kind of look on their face. It just used to irritate me like never before. It's a bit like that character Joy from the Disney film, Inside Out. She's the most annoying character ever. And I think the reason I hated happy people quite so much is because often you discover that it's just an act. Often you discover that that happiness was not real, it was put on. I mean, it is genuinely not possible for anybody to be that happy all the time. Or so I thought. Until we went to theological college and we met a friend of ours, and she's American, and I'm not to be rude, I'm not sure the accent helped, but she was one of those annoying people. And it would wind me up a treat. She was always, always happy, until I realized that this was not an act. But she was not somehow immune to everything that was going on in the world around her. She just happened to be the most joyful person I have ever met. And she really showed me the difference between being happy and being joyful. She showed me that happiness and joyfulness are two very different things. Because being happy, for instance, it's often temporary, isn't it? Because by and large, happiness is circumstantial. We are often happy or not based on what's happening in our lives right now. You know, happiness in that sense is quite a self-centered thing. And it's often something we can try to chase. We chase after happiness, this ultimate feeling. And the more we chase it, the further away it seems to get and the more dissatisfied we get. But if joy is of the spirit, then it can't be like happiness. It can't be something that we're constantly chasing after but will never quite get. So joy has to be different from happiness. And so I thought we could just start by having a look at what the Bible says about joy. In the New Testament, the word joy is used a lot, more than 300 times, and just shy of half of those are in books written by Paul. And I guess in one sense, that's not surprising. Paul wrote a decent chunk of the New Testament. But it is interesting because it tells us that for Paul, Christianity, our faith, is as much about joy as it is about grace. You know, Paul is clear, we are saved by grace, but with our salvation comes joy and the ability to rejoice. Paul says, rejoice in the Lord always. For him, our joy doesn't come from the world or our circumstances. It comes from knowing and receiving Christ and our salvation. And in that sense, our joy should be spontaneous. It occurs as a result only of knowing Jesus. It's not tied to anything earthly. It's not something that we have to chase after or try to create. It occurs within us simply from knowing Jesus. Essentially, wherever Jesus is, joy is. And it's been like that ever since Jesus came to earth. in Luke's gospel, if we read the Christmas story, when Mary is pregnant with Jesus, she goes to see her cousin Elizabeth, and when the women meet, the baby in Elizabeth's womb leaps for joy. Even in the womb, Jesus's presence brought joy. When Jesus is born, the angels appear to announce his birth. They say, "We bring you good news, news of great joy, joy for all the people." When the wise men see the star in the sky announcing the birth of Jesus, we're told that they were overjoyed. In his ministry, when Jesus meets people on earth, he heals them, he talks to them, whenever they witness his power at work, we are told so often that they went from that place rejoicing and worshipping God. People met with Jesus and they were filled with joy. And that was for the case for the people who Jesus met on earth, and it's the same for us today. You know, remember the ascension of Jesus, his final words to his disciples, "Surely I am with you for the end, till the very end of the age." Jesus, the source of our joy, is always with us. The joy of knowing God is always with us comes because God's nature is to be joyful. You know, heaven is full of joy. God rejoices, all of heaven rejoices when someone comes to faith. Just look at the parable of the lost sheep. God's joy comes deep from within us. It should bubble up and come out of us just because we know Jesus. And the more we know Jesus, the more and more evident it should be in our lives, because that joy reflects the very character of God. And it's a joy that enables us to look beyond whatever our current situation might be, because it points us to our eternal hope in Jesus. And that means we can have joy even in suffering. Now, I am not going to lie to you. Joy and suffering is something that I've struggled with a lot. I don't think I'm alone in that. But again, I think it's probably because in our humanness, so often we equate joy with happiness. I mean, how on earth can anyone be joyful when someone they love dies or when they are facing a really, really tough time? But if we look in the Bible, it is definitely something that is there. You know, in the book of James, as disciples of Christ, we are told, "Be filled with joy when you face difficult times." In the book of Hebrews, we are told that Jesus suffered the cross with joy. In the book of Acts, Peter and the other apostles say that they are joyful at being counted worthy to suffer for Christ. Were any of these guys happy? I don't think so. But were they able to find joy in those situations? Yes, because their joy wasn't in a response to the situation. It was in a response to the fact that where they were, Jesus was found also. Where they were, Jesus was at work. And when Jesus is at work, it brings an inner joy, a joy that enables us to see past the present and into the future that God has planned. And you know, that kind of joy is so incredibly powerful. Because this kind of joy is authentic. It's a joy that comes from within, a joy that's not dependent on the world. It is a joy that cannot be faked. You know, more than 20 years ago now, I went to the funeral of a teenager, and to this day, it remains the most joyful service I have ever been to, because it was filled with his family and his friends, all praising God for the gift of his life, holding on to the hope of eternity and to the knowledge that one day they'd be reunited. To this day, it sticks with me as an authentic expression of true joy that can only come from God. Was it a sad day? Were there tears of loss? Yes, of course. But the joy of the Lord, the joy of heaven, shone through. And my goodness, it was powerful. The joy that comes from a relationship with Jesus is not of this world. It is a gift from God, and it is a powerful demonstration of God at work in our lives. But having said that, it is fruit of the Spirit, and as such, we still need to work to nurture it within us. Joy comes from being in the presence of God, and so if we want to find joy, then for my money, we have got to be people who come to worship. Worship brings us into the presence of God. When we read, when we read the Bible, when we pray, when we share communion with one another, when we sing, He is present and He moves among us. When we worship, we know God's love more deeply, and that evokes a joy from within us. It takes our focus off everything that's going on and turns it to God. You know, if Kai had a pound for every time I said, I don't want to go to church today, he'd be rich. Because you know what? It can be a faff sometimes, can't it? Especially when it's winter and it's cold and it's chucking it down with rain. But you know what? Just tuning up, just coming to worship can be transformative. The obedience of saying, I don't really feel like it, but I'm gonna because you're worth it. That obedience allows God to realign my thinking. It resets my priorities. And then invariably, I am glad I came because once again, I rediscover the joy of meeting with Jesus. If we want to cultivate joy, we've got to be people who worship. But we've got to be people too who focus on our discipleship. Worship isn't just about church, is it? It's about our own prayer life, about our Bible study. It's about us being accountable with one another. And when we do all that, we walk in a closer relationship with Jesus. And when we walk in a closer relationship with Jesus, then there is no way our joy won't grow. If we want to have more joy, then we've got to take worship and discipleship seriously. But I think we've also got to be people who get out there and serve others. Last week, Kai talked about love. And you know what? Joy is found in loving others. I can't remember who said it, but I read this thing once and it basically said that as we love and serve others, then we start to worry less about ourselves and we learn to delight in God's other children more. And that is the secret of joy. In other words, the fruit of joy builds on the fruit of love, because where love is, joy is found also. As we serve others in the name of Jesus, we are brought into His presence because we see His work or Him at work in the lives of others. And trust me, that brings more joy than anything else. I asked someone who comes into the well recently if I could pray for them, and they said to me, oh yeah, I've been given prayer a go. And you know what? I think it works. Let me tell you, that sentence brought more joy to my heart. It's indescribable. Kai will tell you that no matter how miserable I am at the beginning of the day, on a day when I have been to the well, I always come home a different person. Why? Because in that place, as we serve others, God blesses us. He comes close to us as we serve others, and as we see Him at work, it brings with it life-transforming joy, even in the face of some of the most heartbreaking realities that our people face. Our joy is found in knowing Jesus and in being in His presence. Our joy comes from seeing Him at work in our lives and in the lives of those around us. And so today I pray that we would be people who seek after God, who seek to learn more of His ways, who seek to worship Him and to serve His world in all that we do. And as we do that, I pray that His joy would just bubble up from deep within us, that His joy would overflow out of us, that we would reflect His love and His joy to the people that we meet, so that they might see that our joy is not a worldly joy, but a joy that comes from knowing Jesus, a joy that comes from knowing that our future and our eternity is held in His hands, a joy that knows, that comes from knowing that God is at work in this place and He is building His kingdom here on earth. Amen.
Though the tears may fall, my song will rise, my song will rise to You. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise to You. While there's breath in my lungs, I will praise You, Lord. In the
dead of night, I'll lift my eyes to you. When the waters rise, I'll lift my eyes to you. While there's hope in this heart, I will praise you, Lord. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength.
Father God, we give thanks for the gift of joy, and we give thanks that joy comes through you, and we give thanks that we can give thanks in all circumstances, and in our thanksgiving there is joy as well. So we lift our thanks to you now. Thanks for the things that have happened this day. Thanks for the things that have happened in this week. Thanks for all the blessings that we have. And whether we are living through a good time, a difficult time, or somewhere in between, that we would recognize your goodness to us and we would take joy. And Lord, we pray as we consider this issue of joy today for those who feel that they are without it. And be that people we know and love, or maybe ourselves, we pray by your Spirit for an outpouring of joy upon us. As we pray, Lord God, for the parts of the world where it feels like there is no joy at this time, we pray for the horrific and ongoing situation in Ukraine. We pray for the nations that are still struggling with COVID. We pray for our nation, the cost of living crisis and all the fear that brings. We pray that in these difficult times, your joy would sustain us, and that in these difficult times we would lift our eyes to you and you would bring the solutions that are needed. With that in our minds, we pray for those who lead us. We pray for those in government. We pray for those who make decisions for us, and we pray that you would give them wisdom to lead and lead us. And we pray that as they lead, they would do so with the heart of your Son, Jesus Christ. And Lord, we pray for the places where we live, for our communities. We pray for our streets, our cul-de-sacs. We pray for our neighbours, for those who live on the left, those who live on the right, those who live behind, those who live opposite. We pray for our villages and our towns and our cities. And we lift to you the local problems that there are. And we pray that you would intervene in those places and bring all that is needed. And Lord, we lift to you all who are in special need, and especially those who are in need of healing now. And whether healing need is in body, in mind, or in spirit, we pray that healing would come and that your joy would be felt. And Lord, we pray that as we journey into this day, as we journey into this week, we would walk in your ways, in the way that leads to everlasting life. May we walk joyfully. In your name we pray. Amen.
Service is coming to an end, but the work of church continues throughout the week. So if you'd like to find out what's going on in church life, why not sign up to our newsletter? All you need to do is drop us an email to office@stmikes.net and we will send that over to you. Also, if you would like prayer for absolutely anything, nothing too big or too small, all you need to do is send your prayer requests over to prayer@stmikes.net or get in touch with the office to organise a one-to-one prayer session over the phone or via Zoom. Now, before you go, let me bless you. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and give you his peace, this day and always. Amen. Have a wonderful week.